Alright guys, welcome back to Matchue GANs. I'm so glad you guys could come back for a second episode. Today we're going to be talking about data augmentation and gradient penalties. And we're going to be talking about doing more with less. So we want to do more with less data. So, to start off, let's talk about data augmentation. So today I'm going to be generating pictures of motorbikes. Unfortunately though, I'm not really that good at scraping data, and so I've only gotten 961 images of motorcycles, and that's the best that I can do. Now, when we're training generative adversarial networks, 961 images is not very much data. So, what can we do to generate more images and better looking images with such a small amount of data? Well, today we're going to be talking about data augmentation and gradient penalties. These are both things which will help to stabilize the generative adversarial network training process. So first, let's talk about data augmentation. Data augmentation, simply put, is just a way of getting more images out of just a set of images. So to start, the most basic form of data augmentation, which I actually did in the last episode without telling you guys, is just simply flipping horizontally all of the images in your data set. So what I did is with all the flower images from last episode, I simply took them and flipped them all horizontally. So we got double the amount as we would usually have. But the next one, the one that we're going to be implementing today, is called random cropping or something like that. You can call it whatever you want. So the way that we do this is by when we resize our images, we resize them slightly above what we actually need them to be. So as you will notice later, I have resized all my images to 80 by 80 instead of 64 by 64. And so what we will do during training time then is that we will randomly select a 64 by 64 square of that image and we will crop it out, and that is going to be the training sample for that use case. So here we can see an example of this where I've gotten the red squares put around just random areas in the images of these motorcycles. And so this is the kind of idea that we're going to be implementing today, as well as gradient penalties. So now, moving on, we can talk about gradient penalties. First, let's talk about these few pieces of code. So first, we're going to be importing our packages. Same stuff, simple as last time. And next up, we're going to be setting our hyperparameters and setting our statistics. We did not see the GP loss list last time, but this is going to be going along with our gradient penalty, so we can talk about that in a little bit. So now we'll want to import our data. I've called it motorbikes80.numpy. This is simply because these are 80 by 80 images of motorbikes. Next, we'll want to normalize the data, and let's see a couple examples of what kind of data we're working with today. So here we've already implemented a little bit of data augmentation. So we will select two different random values between 0 and 16 for the cropping values. One will be for the x-axis and the other one will be for the y-axis. So now we will want to grab our real images and crop them along those x and y axes that we got just a moment ago. Next, we will want to plot these out so that we can actually see these images. So as you can see, we start off with 1,922 images, and then we can continue on to actually look at what these images look like. As you can see, regular motorbike images. Finally now, we can go on to look at what our gradient penalty is doing. So the reason why we want to insert a gradient penalty is because sometimes instability can come in a generative adversarial network. And a lot of times, this comes from the discriminator having something called exploding gradients. This means that the discriminator, when telling the generator what to do, it will randomly say, whoa, you should change these pixels by a very large value. And we don't want it to do that, because when it wants to change values by a lot, then the generator will change its weights by a lot. And then the discriminator will then in turn change its own weights by a lot. And these will go back and forth until eventually they're just completely out of whack and what's called collapsed. In which case, none of the images look very realistic and it's very bad. This is especially common in datasets where we don't have a lot of images. So what we can do is we can directly penalize these gradients at the beginning of our discriminator so that we can make it a little more stable and a little less explosive. So we are going to be implementing what's called an R1 gradient penalty today. So, we will start off by getting the gradients of the image. Now we're using Keras as our backend for this, as usual. And so to get the gradients, we will get the k.gradients function, which takes in two parameters. First, it takes off the predictions that the discriminator had, and then it will take in the samples that were given to the discriminator in order to get to those predictions. So now that we have the gradients of all our different weights, we want to just take the first layer. The reason we're only taking the first layer is we only want the differences in pixel values that I mentioned earlier. Next, we will get what's called the norm of this. You could think of this as the distance. So, first we will square all of our gradient values, that's all the different pixel values, and then we will add them all up for each image. So that's why we use k.square, and then we use k.sum, but we only want to do it in three different axes because we want each individual image to have their own value. And then finally, we want to get the average over all of those. So that seems simple enough. So now we can move on to the other changes that I've made to this code since the last episode. So I've also kind of automated the G block and D block. So last episode, we had simply written out upsampling, convolution, and activations and that sort of thing over and over and over again. And I've simply turned that into one simple function so that we can simplify the making of our generator and discriminator. So starting off with this generator block, I've simply said, okay, well, we're gonna take an upsampling, convolution, and activation block. Same with the discriminator block, convolution, activation, and pooling. So now we can look at our generator and discriminator, and we can see that they are much simpler to build. So we just do reshaping the latent vector, G block, G block, G block, G block, and then an image output. So that is quite a simple method compared to how we did it last week. And same with the discriminator. We add just discriminator blocks after discriminator blocks till we finally get to the end of the model. So we are now moving into a tricky spot, in which case we want to train the discriminator with the gradient penalty. But we are moving into this tricky spot where we are not using true labels, but we're actually just using the predicted labels and the samples that were input. So now we have to kind of work around this and add that third variable to the loss function. So what we're gonna do down here is have a partial gradient penalty. So this is a partial function. So what we'll wanna do is we'll start off with our R1 gradient penalty function, and then we'll wanna set exactly what all of the additional values are. So here, our samples that we're inputting are going to be the real images that we input into our model. So now we have a partial GP loss function, which only needs Y true and Y predicted. So now when we compile our discriminator model, we can simply use the same inputs as last time, but now we have an additional output, which is just the validity of those real images, the judgments or predictions of those outputs. Now, we can use three different loss functions, the mean squared error and mean squared error that we used last time, and finally, our partial gradient penalty function. Next, we will want to use loss weights. These loss weights means that we're going to give special treatment to certain loss functions. We're going to weigh them in more during training. The reason why we want to do this is because the gradients that we're penalizing are going to be quite small, very much smaller than the actual discriminator loss functions that we use typically. So we will want to give this a weight of 10. So each of the loss values from the gradient penalty are going to be multiplied by 10. And all of the other losses are just multiplied by 1 to stay the same. And so now we've compiled our model and we are ready to move on. Of course, as usual, we want to also compile our generator model. This one is the exact same. We don't use any gradient penalties here as we only want to stop the discriminator from exploding, but the generator is typically pretty well behaved, and so we don't typically need any gradient penalties on it. Now we can move on to our training loop. So we will start off by getting our real labels, our fake labels, and our dummy labels. Our dummy labels are what we're going to use for the gradient penalty loss function. We don't actually use these labels, as you recall, we don't need any true labels, we only need the predictions and the samples. So these are just a placeholder for Keras. Next, we will want to do the data augmentation that we did earlier. So we'll want to get two random values between 0 and 16 for the cropping values, grab the images, and crop them as so. Finally, we'll get our latent vectors as usual, and we'll get our loss value, append the loss value of the discriminator, and then finally, append the loss value of the gradient penalty, which is going to be very interesting for us to look at later. Then we will want to train our generator. This one, again, just very typical. You'll want to grab your latent vectors, train your generator, and that's about it. So now this has been training for a little while already, but I just wanted to get to 50,000 iterations so that you guys can see some really good looking images, rather than last time where we only had 10,000 iterations. So I will get back to you guys shortly when this is done. So I'll see you guys then. All right, welcome back, guys. Now we've gone through all 50,000 iterations, and now we can take a look into what kind of results we've gotten from these new stabilization techniques. So we can generate a couple new images, and as you can see here, we've got a couple, you know, motorcycle looking images. They're not perfect, of course, but again, we started off with very little amounts of data. So here we can see a lot of features that you might find in different motorcycles. So maybe a wheel, maybe a back wheel back here, and we've got like the actual parts of a motorcycle that you can see. Whereas if we hadn't done all this data augmentation or stabilization, we might not have actually been able to pick up on these features. And of course, if you want better images, you can train it for much longer than just 50,000 iterations. And now we can go down and we can look at our loss functions. So as you can see, the discriminator and generator stuck around the same point throughout most of training. But our gradient penalty values ended up starting off by spiking. So this is kind of expected as they both start to initialize themselves in the right area. And then it just slowly but surely went up and up and up as it became closer to collapsing. So you can imagine, as if we didn't have all this data augmentation, instead of slowly going up in this gradient penalty, we would be going up much faster until eventually it became very unstable, very big gradients. But here, now that we have our data augmentation, it's done it very, very slowly. And so now we could probably train this for maybe 100,000, maybe 200,000 more iterations before we actually collapsed. Collapse typically happens when the discriminator will overfit, and that's when the gradients might explode. So in other words, it might memorize the images that it's been shown. All right, so that does it for this episode, guys. I'm glad you guys tuned in. I hope you guys learned a little bit. Feel free to leave any questions down in the comments. And if you enjoyed the video, leave a like. And thank you for tuning in. I'll see you guys next time.